What is up, Crazy X? Out here in a small little city, we can call it Castle Rock. It's also known as Brownsville. Did this event last year, so I figured I'd come back, do it again. Second time out here. It's a Stand By Me Day. It's based off the novel The Body, written by Stephen King. This course turned into the movie Stand By Me, which everybody knows that one. Signed up for the walking tour, so check that out. It's kind of cool. Last year, came down here, knew nothing about it. Met four people, and then we kind of went on our own separate adventure through the town, and we even stumbled across a dead body, a living dead. The guy who played the dead body, so that's kind of cool. But yeah. Walking tour begins in a few minutes. So, see you guys for that.
That's all we have.
Okay.
Available for you today. So behind you, this is going to sort of be the hub of activity. We've got blueberry pie slices for sale, obviously. We also have ice cream right next door, so you can do that a la mode as well. We've got the info booth. There's going to be games here, including hula hoops, because apparently that's what they did in the 50s. So there's that as well here. And later on at 1 p.m. there's a fan forum right downtown, which I will show you where that is. As well at 3 p.m. and I'm counting on the young ones to sign up for this, there's going to be a blueberry pie eating contest, and it's always the young ones that win it. So and that's just down the road at Randy's Cafe, and I will point out where that is as well. So let's head into town.
Is that generator going to be on the whole time?
I sincerely hope not, but probably. We do have the food truck, so they have to Brownsville proper, right downtown. And I just wanted to point out, for those of you that are obsessive about the movie and notice every single thing, do you remember this sign? This sign. So when we cross the street later on, we're going to have the view that Gordy first had and what we first had of the movie as well. But as he's walking across, you can see the sign, and it's painted blue and it says laundromat on it. And so a lot of we can't really consider it a prop because it was always there, but it does, you do see it in the movie as well. Now, coming up here, do you guys see where it says fitness center? Do you remember that?
Yeah.
From this? Yeah. Yeah, it rings a bell. When we see it from across the street later, you'll remember it more. But again, when Gordy's walking by, he goes right past it. And when we go past the window, you will see that's where they had the sign. Who can tell me what year this film was set?
It was in the 80s, wasn't it?
Well, it was made in the 80s, but it was set in, what did you say?
59.
59. Who gets a cherry Pez? Oh. You do. yes, so when you walk by the window at the fitness center, that's where they had the sign that said Quilting Bee 1950. Yes, everyone remembers. Awesome. All right, let's walk up here, and I'm going to point out a couple of businesses that we can sort of tie in Stand By Me to right here.
Benevolent Order of Antelope Leader.
Right here.
Good morning.
You will never meet another leader of the Benevolent Order.
I don't know. We're a fraternal organization that supports Castle Rock.
That's right, that's right. We're so happy to have them here. Yep. And this is their headquarters right here, and I highly recommend going in there after. They actually have some beautiful artwork, much of it Stand By Me related. And highly recommend that you have a chance to go in. And again, I don't know if all of you were here when we were first talking about it, but these guys were the ones that got barfed on by the women's auxiliary. So you were very clean today, I must say. You cleaned up well.
We do clean up. And the order meets every second Thursday at 7:07.
Yes, if they can be bothered to show up.
If we can be bothered to show up.
Yeah. Yep. So
our numbers are growing. We're up to over 16 members now.
High five. All right, so I recommend coming to check these guys out. Beautiful artwork in there as well. So
and if you ask the proprietor of the shop here, she has a special gift for anyone who comes in. You just got to ask for it.
Okay. See, it's good to know people in the know, isn't it? All right. I'm hoping that he will open up. This gentleman here is called LB Productions, and he has a connection to Rob Reiner. And who was Rob Reiner?
The director.
Director, that's right. I'll give you candy at the end for that. Rob Reiner was the director of Stand By Me. And he was a well-known actor before that. And he has done many well-known movies since. And Stephen King, Rob Reiner adapted Stand By Me from a Stephen King short story. It was called The Body. And so when Rob Reiner got a hold of it, it was originally going to be set in Maine, where a lot of Stephen King's movies are set and books are set in Maine. When he got here, the welcoming by the town and the beauty of the town is what inspired him to change it to Castle Rock, Oregon. So Rob Reiner loved it here. And Stephen King, again, a lot of his movies have been adapted into, or books have been adapted into movies. When he first saw the showing of this movie in 1986, he had to leave the theater. He was so overcome with emotion. It was his favorite adaptation to date. So Stand By Me is very, very special. So this gentleman here worked with Rob Reiner behind the scenes on the movie The American President. And that also starred Richard Dreyfuss, who was the adult Gordy in Stand By Me. So see how it all comes together. Also, if you're into zombie movies, he made a zombie movie. So you can talk to him if he shows up today.
And there's stars. Were there names in here?
Oh, do it. He just does this as part of his whole Hollywood thing. Yeah. Awesome. Come on over.
Oh, there's some old buildings here.
Yeah, lots of old.
Where is Brownsville from? I see some 1895.
Absolutely. Settled as part of the Oregon Trail. They ended up in Linn County in the 1880s.
So after the Civil War.
Oh, yes. So I just wanted to point out behind you, so this is where you see in the movie where it says The Quilting Bee 1959. So that sort of sets the tone for the movie. You know what era you're in and where you are. So let's head on out this way. Am I telling you things you didn't know?
you gave me, reminded me about that sign.
Oh, yes. Yes. I'm
approving of all your things.
Well,
you're
thank
doing
you.
A great job.
You'll get a cherry kiss for that. You just have to suck up to the tour guide. That's all.
It's been a while trying to get anyone to sign that.
Oh, did
eventually find it. Yes. I assume we're heading that way.
We sure are. I'm going to let this person go. You go ahead. Oh, okay. So I'm just going to bring everyone in. We'll get in the shade. That way you stay nice and cool. No heat stroke on the tour. So if you just came here today and you didn't know anything else and you only stood on this corner, you can say that you saw a lot of the movie. So much action started right here. So a few things I'll point out. We are going to cross the street. There's our own personal crossing guard just for us today. And we will go over. But before we do, I wanted to point out a couple things. Look across the street. See that yellow greenhouse? Whose house is that?
Teddy,
yay, high fives. There will be candy at the end. Absolutely. This is where we say at the end of the movie, when they've crossed the bridge, it's early morning, beautiful, and they're saying their goodbyes. We see Teddy going over there singing his, you know, doing his little thing, weird old Teddy. And that's where he goes. It looks a little, the house looks very similar, but at that time, the roads weren't paved. There were none of those signs there. It was all dirt over there. So when you watch it again.
Can I ask a question? Does anyone here have a silver Toyota?
Come on.
Toyota. silver.
Oh, okay, perfect. Lovely. So, Teddy there. Now, if we look down the road here, you can see that beautiful Italianate style building there. When we first, when the boys are first setting out on their adventure in the morning, Chris comes up, he's heading down the road here, and he gets dropped off in the back of a pickup truck. Do you remember that?
Right, yeah.
Yeah, he hitches a ride. So right where the Pioneer Picture Gallery is, he gets dropped off there. And at that time also, you see Gordy walking towards us, and he's right in front of that beautiful house. It's called the Moyer House there. And the retaining walls are still there. The trees have grown up, so it looks a little different than if you were to watch it in the movie. But that's where you see Gordy coming up. You see Chris getting dropped off there. They meet each other, and they head down where we meet the Bad Boys. We'll talk about that later. What else happened here?
Penny.
Who's Penny?
Hey.
Burns Penny, yes. So Brownsville absolutely embraces Stand By Me Day, and they know pennies are very important, as do you. And they embedded a penny in there just for the fans. And it's actually, if you go into Google Earth, it actually says Burns Penny. So, I mean, people come here just to see that. So in a few moments, we're going to cross the street, and he's going to finally stop traffic. And they will kindly stop for us, and you can take a very quick picture of Vern's penny, okay? So let's head on over there. Look at you, we're coming through. You betcha. So it's six lines in. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7. There we go.
Take your time.
You're so good to us. Thank you.
It's a big deal. That's why I'm here.
Make sure everybody takes your time to sleep. Bye. I've called the sheriff too if somebody steals the game.
Oh, yeah. You go to jail immediately.
That's right.
Thank you so much. And you guys can go back
after.
Okay,
you turn around.
Look at this.
That was okay.
Turn around, then there you go.
And you can see, so he's walking, see? And then this is him picking up his beloved penny.
What's interesting is that is the tree there in the movie. It was small. I don't know if that's the same one right there or not, but it's quite a bit bigger.
Oh, absolutely. Well, think it's been 38 years, you guys. You have to come back for the 40th. We'll make it a big party. So, yeah, so that happened here. Now, I wanted to point out, we're not going to walk down to the bridge because it's a bit of a long walk. But if you guys get the chance to get your pictures and go in the middle of the road, don't get run over by anyone and pretend you're the boys in the morning when they're coming home. That's also another place where they filmed. We see the Bad Boys there. We see two of the Bad, the Cobras there. And that's where they were giving up the secret that they held for $186, right? Do not tell them anything you don't want them to know, that they should know. So that's where, that's what also happened down there. So I recommend doing that. Now, we are not going to go all the way down, but if you follow this road right down to the bottom, you will end up at Pioneer Park. I think I saw you there yesterday.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
If you go down there, that is the site of the complete and total Barforama. And it was just such a funny day that day. It was very, very hot when they filmed here in 1985. They did it in July and August. And they had a pile of blueberries, but they were supposed to be like rat guts and all that kind of stuff and look gross and make them want to bark, right? So down there, they were filming it, and that day, Rob Reiner was wearing all white. And one of the young girls that was an extra in the movie saw him, and she was covered in bark and blueberry bark. And she ran up to him and gave him the biggest hug, and he was covered. And he was like, but anyway, I recommend going down to Pioneer Park, and you can see where the Barforama took place. We're going to head across the street here. And I'll be on your own.
The telephone pole, yeah, the firefighter was still there. He was dealing with the telephone pole.
I just want to point out here, there's Teddy. Aw, I always felt sad for Teddy. He had a rough life. he had PTSD. His dad had PTSD, although they don't say it in the movie, but they very much acknowledge that that was what was happening. He had a very unstable life. Didn't really make it too far, but in the end, he was just Teddy. And then you can see here the boys walking, just right in this area here. And I do recommend afterwards, if you want, you can go into City Hall, and if you go upstairs, they have the original Castle Rock sign up there. And they also have an homage to River Phoenix, who died at the age of 23, who played Chris Chambers. So someone who loved him did that. So that's up there as well. Listen, they're going to sing. They're serenading you. They're going to be all over town today. So I don't know how long to wait because we're standing in the sun, but Chris, Doherty, Byrne, and Teddy are going to be walking down this hill in a few minutes. Do you guys want to stay and see it? I think it should just be a couple of minutes. If you're too hot, it's okay. We can move, but if you want to see it, you can. Or they'll be around after.
Now, is it City Hall where they do the tribute to River
Phoenix? They do. It is upstairs in City Hall, and that's where you can see it. You know what I'm going to recommend, folks? Just being a tour guide, I know what it's like to stand out here. We don't really know when they're coming. They will be around town. So if you want, we're just going to head down the street here, and if we see them, we'll get pictures with them. Oh, here they come. Okay, we'll stay. Here's our boys.
That's cute. That's really cute. Aww. You see them?
So we've got Teddy on the left, we've got Chris next to him, we've got Doherty, and then we have Vern on the right.
They look just like him from afar.
They don't like him. Don't you think they feel like stars right now with the paparazzi standing around?
Paparazzi band.
Have to give the locals credit. They're very, very patient today. We'll give them about 30 seconds and we'll head on over.
That's so great.
That's so cute. Oh, aw, thanks guys. Thanks for being patient. We'll continue on this way and you can meet the boys after. How to get there if you want to go. Again, it's on private property, so if you do go up to see where it is, they just ask that you take pictures from the road. Fair enough, they don't want anyone climbing the tree, falling, suing, you know, the whole thing. So anyway, feel free, you guys should come back and get family photo and get pictures here as well. Let's head on down.
Guys, let me take a quick photo of you guys.
Here's a great picture, you can see. And they used to have two trees in front of it, or I think three here, but clearly they've taken those down since.
I volunteer in Sonoma County at American Legion.
Oh, yeah.
For like 7 years. I needed a teacher.
Well, if you are back here for 1 o'clock, they're going to have a fan forum in here.
Okay. So
actually, yeah, let's come on over this way. to the Legion. So, folks, I just wanted to point out the American Legion here, right behind this lovely lady here in the striped shirt. It says, Stand By Me Inside. At 1 p.m. today, they're going to have a fan forum. And it's so much fun. You can ask questions. Sometimes they have people who were involved in it. They even had one of the Cobras here at one point who was answering questions. I don't know if he's here today. But I highly recommend it if you're around to come back for 1 o'clock. It's a great way to get involved. So we're going to head down here, and I want you to look across the street. You'll have a better idea of what Gordy saw and what we saw at the beginning of the week. Here, and then that you can see the laundromat sign that we saw earlier there, and I was wrong, it's not blue, it's a darker brown, it looks like there, but this is where he was, and that's the street right here. There's one of the very 12, first lines. Yes, he was 12 going on 13 the first time he saw life. Yes. Now I heard a rumor that Ray Brower might be around town today. I don't know if we'll see him. If we do, he'll probably be closer to a train. So keep an eye out for Ray Brower. Yes. Yeah. Don't have nightmares, please. So we're gonna put that back here. Yeah. Come on down.
Maybe that's what we'll do.
Oh, sorry. Thank you. Mm-hmm. So this is a great shot of exactly what we were just talking about. He was leaving, we just passed, the pharmacy. And in the background music, I'm trying to blank, which one and one, I can't remember. Anyway, that's where he's going, and we can see him right here, and look at what truck is behind us. The truck from the movie. The same one. He is here every year, and he holds a place of honor right in this spot here. So one thing I want to point out, we were talking about the tree house up behind here, up on that hill, there's a brand new house there, but that's where the tree house was. So I will show you again when we get a little bit closer how you can get up there, but not a lot has changed. It still looks like the same place. But also, there's another scene that took place up there. Remember the saddest part of the movie when we found out that Chris Chambers had been fatally stabbed when he tried to break up a fight? The last scene that we see of him walking away before he fades is up, just up here on this hill. So, rest in peace, Chris Chambers. Real one too, so yeah, that's the spot. So we're gonna take you down here and meet the bad boys, the Cobras. This is where Gordy walked out of. Gather everyone down around here. Hi. Thanks. I'm gonna steal this. This was one of the, for me, one of the most exciting places to see for the first time. I love a good bad boy. And Ace Scott was about as bad as they got, wasn't he? He was a jerk. But do you know who I always thought was the bigger jerk? Was Eyeball Chambers standing next to him, because he was Chris Chambers' brother and he should have protected him. And he was not very nice to him, was he? Even at the very end, when Ace was threatening him with a knife, he sort of stuck up, but not really, it didn't count. So this is where we meet them, and what did he take from Gordy, his beloved?
Baseball cap.
That's right. Which team?
New York Mets.
Up close, Yankees, that's right. His beloved New York Yankees hat, which his beloved brother, Denny LeChance, gave to him, right? And so, I didn't like him. I thought, you're too bad for me. So, this here, you can see the Blue Diner or the Blue Point Diner sign. So it wasn't there in the movie, but I thought it was very nice that the owner of this building put that up. So technically it is a prop. It's just not in the right area. It would have just been down this way here, which you can kind of see as they're walking towards it. We will go around into the back alley and we will see where the actual Blue Point Diner was back there. So this is the Brownsville Saloon. I recommend checking it out after. Apparently they still have one of the original pool tables that they had in there when the Cobras were in their plane. And that's where Charlie Hogan, one of the Cobras, told Ace about the dead body. So again, he had held his secret for how many hours? 36. That's right, a record 36 hours. Way to go, boys. So we're going to put that there, and we're going to take you down this way. I'm genuinely hoping someone has the guts to do this today. I don't, but I'm hoping someone does. These lovely people here, there's three artists there. Oh, maybe we'll just move in a little bit just so these folks can get by. Thank you. These wonderful people are doing a flash sale today, and they're doing Stand By Me tattoos. Not fake, real. About 100 to 150, give or take, and they have a whole bunch of different designs designed especially for today. So if anyone has the guts today to go get a Stand By Me tattoo, I know you're thinking about it. I see it. You can come here. They're lovely people. So hopefully we'll have some customers. Yep, yep, yep. Find some shade, cool down a bit if you would like. So we're gonna, it's all coming together, isn't it? Yes. So, yeah, it is. The owie, I love it. So we're gonna be coming up to the end of our tour here very shortly, but one thing I want to point out, we were talking about the treehouse, and I'd like to tell you how to get there. If you look behind you, if you follow this road up here, on the right-hand side, just past the church, is going to be a retaining wall. That retaining wall has two sets of stairs. There's the first set of stairs, which go up to someone's private property. The second set of stairs will take you to School Avenue. And School Avenue is a steep, short hill like this. And on the right-hand side, you will be able to see the tree from that property there, okay? So you can get there by walking. You can also get there by driving. You would just continue on a little bit further, take the first right road. And the owner up there is really good. He expects people to be up there taking pictures all day, so I highly recommend it if you want to go up there and have a look. So we're gonna take you down, and who's gonna be the Lone Ranger or the Cisco Kid?
One of
you. One of you. All right, let's head on down here.
Sorry.
So again, this is very thoughtful, but it is not the correct spot. I'm going to take you to the correct. Tour, and this is where the legendary Taco Babe came out of. Remember her? She was all full of sauce and spice. Yeah, she came out here. She wasn't happy with the boys because what were they doing back here?
Shooting.
That's right, shooting. That's right. They weren't letting off cheer bombs or anything like that, which she thought they were. They actually were shooting out here. So this is where we had Gordy and Chris, and they had it was Chris who had hawked his old man's gun, right, off the bureau that morning, because his dad was always drunk, he didn't know what was going on, he got away with it, stole some cigarettes, stole his gun, like you did in the 50s, right, and this is where they go. So what happened, let me see, we've got another picture here, there we go. So this is Gordy. He has no idea at this point that the gun is loaded, and so he's just playing around the way boys do, and sure enough, what happens? It goes off and he hits the garbage can, and that really sets Tupper Babe off. She comes out here, she's a waitress, she doesn't have time for this, and she comes out here and gets mad at them. So I'm going to ask, who wants to be the Lone Ranger of the Cisco Kid? I think we should get some pictures, don't you? Yeah, let's get some pictures. Okay, so how about you be the Lone Ranger? How about you be the Cisco? Okay, come on over. So this will be a nice photo walk. If anyone else who's here who wants to get a picture taken, I can get mad at you if you want. I can be Tucker Babe. It's fine. So parents, you've got your camera.
You got it.
You know what? Hang on. I feel like I might have bear with me. A script. Yeah. Otherwise, it's just a photo walk, isn't it? There we go. Okay. So who's gonna be Gordian? You don't care. She's like, you're just forcing me to do something I don't want to do. Okay. I found the script online. If anyone wants to do this, that's the beauty of the internet. You can find anything nowadays. Okay. All right. So who's Chris? How about your Chris? Okay. So Chris says, hang on here. Mm-hmm. Chris says, that's your line.
Okay.
All right. You say it.
I'm the Lone Ranger of Cisco
Kid. He hands you the gun. All right. Jesus, where'd you get that? And he says he hopped it out of his old man's bureau. Okay, good. And so Gordy takes it. He's looking at it. Chris says,
45.
Look at her. She didn't have to be counted on that one. She knew it. Great. Yes. So 9 of them. All that was left in the box. My dad will think he used it himself. Blah, blah, blah. And then Gordy says, Is it loaded? And he says, and you say, wow. He says,
Chris says, ma'am.
Now you shoot it. Yeah, and then Tupper may come down.
Jesus!
Yeah, now you have to run. High five, they did a great job. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much for joining today. And if you do want to go off on your own, you can head down here. I'm going to say if anyone is allergic to wasps, we just discovered yesterday a huge wasp nest on the orange building just up here. So run past or go the long way around. That will take you down to where you just saw the four boys walking. So if you head down to the very end here, you can go down to Pioneer Park. You can head up there to School Avenue to go see the treehouse, where the treehouse was. Or you can head downtown and enjoy the festivities. So before you go, what did we promise?
All right,
help yourself.
Okay,
you're welcome. There you go.
All right, so finished the walking tour. Up here by one of the houses. It's funny, ran into the tour guide from last year. He didn't lead my tour this year, but we were talking and he said that the tour is kind of a little long for some people, so they've greatly reduced it, which I noticed. Didn't really stop by any place new. I know they were talking about in the past how it kind of changes, and there were places last year that they didn't do this year and stuff. But yeah, this year I didn't really notice anything different. But yeah, still really cool to check out, see where the movie was filmed at. Nice to have someone else's story. Their different perspective of stuff. So yeah, definitely would recommend checking it out. And I'm gonna check out some other sites. It's kind of interesting, today of course being a Tuesday, last year was a leap year on a Sunday. those kind of wondering, what are you filming? Actually, just put it down this way a little bit. So we got that. Yep. That is the bridge leading into Castle Rock. Funny, they have a crossing guard for the penny. It would be nice if they got a second crossing guard right here. But yeah, hardware store behind me. This is it. Back into town. Yeah, nice little town. July 23rd every year, Stand By Me Day, Brownsville, Oregon. Have the fan forum coming up at 1, so we'll go check that out.
Movie was filmed. Maybe we should finally have an event. So they decided to start planning, and they asked if I would be on the committee. And I think I had only seen the movie once, and maybe not all the way through. But I thought, why not? Let's see what we can do. So I did some research, thought, is there somebody who could show the movie for us? I found a company out of Texas that was actually going around the country and showing the movie where it was filmed. And they wrote back and said that we were on the short list. So we got them involved. And the next thing I knew, I read in our local The Times newspaper, Linda McCormick, chairman of the event. So you gotta be careful. If you live in small towns, you never know what's gonna happen. So, but it was so fun to have the one event, made people smile. It was just an amazing experience. And so we decided, let's just keep having them. So we did have a problem getting volunteers to do a big event every year. So we shut down for a couple. I talked to the folks who do Goonies, and they said they chose a date so that it was a little easier during the week to plan a smaller event, and that's what we've done. So that's why it's on July 23rd. We set it up so that when in 2016 was the 30th anniversary, we needed it to land on a Saturday. And in this little teeny town, we had so many events going on, the only Saturday available that summer was July 23rd. So, we like to party around here, I guess. So, so I've been doing it ever since. And, to have people come in and fulfill dreams. I've had some people share some stories that they dreamed all their lives to be here to see where the movie was filmed, and it's worth it.
Yep. Any questions? Nobody.
They know everything.
All right. All right, so what we're going to do next, we're going to introduce to you one of the cast members.
Wait,
oh, go ahead.
Before we do that, we now have in the corner the Stand By Me singers, and they would like to sing a song.
Gotcha. Yeah. This caught me off guard. Oh, Stand By Me?
the night has come, and the land is dark, and the moon is the only light we'll see.
No, I won't.
No, I won't be afraid.
No, I won't.
No, I won't
be afraid.
No, I won't be afraid.
Just as long
as you stand, standing.
So everybody, this is Kent. Anybody know who this guy is?
The body.
The body. That's right. Kent is that guy. So everybody, please welcome in Kent. We'll let him do some talking here. And we'll share some of the movie, and we'll talk about that too.
It's my first microphone. Tell you a little bit about the movie. Is that what you said, Chris?
Sure.
Well, that's a big opening. That's a lot of... what do you guys want to know about? Do you have any specific questions? I've done this a couple times, but... Tanya?
Do you still keep in touch with any other actors?
Not so much the actors. Some of the... Well, Corey Pollard, who played... Who did he play?
He was Moki.
Moke, yeah. Look, a couple of the crew members I've kept in touch with. Some of the camera guys. They went on to be, like, stars in their own field. Like the camera people and stuff like that. Yeah, of course, Sherry, I was a stand-in. I started out as a stand-in. So the actors, if you don't know in film, you'll have stand-ins for the lead actors, and they come in and they set the lighting and the sound levels and everything on them. And then they run off and sit down, and then the actors come in and do the scene. So I was just telling my son, Reed, who's back there, that it's the only movie I've been in where I was a stand-in, and I was in every single shot. Like, I was there for everything. Normally, now I'm a stunt coordinator. I do the action sequences and periodically first unit stuff with actors if they're fighting or doing whatever. But in Stand By Me, I got to be there for everything. And they tasked me with, they turned me into a PA, production assistant, for some time, which is not a good job. It's a job you have to do if you're getting into production, but you don't want that job. You know, that was the first movie I'd ever done. I got it on a joke from my roommate in college. They said they were looking for short people to double these kids who were 18 years old.
And how tall are you?
Well, now or then?
You were
about 5'3". I was about 5'4" back then. Anyway, it was weird because it was actually involved. It was 4 interviews to be a stand-in. They don't do it that way anymore. Now it's just fast, and as fast as they can make it and get the money back, that's the way to do it. But
do you still dabble in any of the film industry, anything? Any kind of connections?
Oh, yeah, no, I've been in the film industry since then. I've been in the business since full time since 1989. So, yeah, I'm in the stunt world. I do stunts, not so much the actual gags anymore. More coordinating. A lot of them are kind of boutique films. I can't think of. There's some. I did an Amazon show called Hunters. I've done a couple of Paramount things that are streaming now. Let's see. I've got a film coming out called Strange Darling. It comes out in August. It's a horror movie, though. It's a little rough.
Did you have to do many takes?
Just two takes. I don't know what I remember. More than anything, just being the center of attention, which back then, I was super introverted. You know, you fake it and try to pretend like you're not, for all the introverts out there. To this day, I still think I am, but people deny that. But, you know, it was fun because you've been with this crew. This is the very end of the shooting, and the crew knows you well, and, you know, you try to be supportive and work hard and with everybody and help people out. And I remember, for whatever reason, I remember when Monty put that slash on my neck with his spatula, and I'm like, don't cut my neck. I was young. I don't think I was hungover, actually.
I love it. And he's also in here again, so when the Benevoli Brothers are in there, during the time when they... So I can get to that real quick.
What? I didn't even know this.
You did say it?
I didn't know I was in anything else.
You're also, when the Benevoli Brothers puke, you're also in the background, and you watch Kent, because he's right back there, and he goes, ah. Waiting for it here, sorry. Everybody loves this scene, right?
Boss man Bob Cormier took one look at Phil Travis and thought about Principal Wiggins.
This was fun to shoot.
Principal Wiggins barked on a lumberjack sitting next to him. Mayor Grundy barked on his...
There's Kent in the back there.
But when the smell hit the crowd, that's when Mara's plan really started to work.
Girls
barfed on boyfriends. Kids barfed on their parents. A fat lady barfed in her purse. The Donald...
See that look? Look at that look.
The Benevolent Order of Antelope.
I see that right back there right now.
They're planning on being at the pie eating contest this afternoon. I thought about suggesting they bring umbrellas, though.
Probably a good thing at that point. So there you go. There's a little special thing. I didn't know that until I talked to him the first time I came here. He was in the other scenes here in the pie eating contest. During that scene, was it really hot in the tent? I've heard conflicting things at the time of the shooting of this.
I'm sure it was. I don't know that I remember. I really don't. Yeah, I'm sure it was.
Once again, everybody, make some noise for the VOA. Yes, you're looking good. I like that. I like the shades. That's cool. All right, we're going to move on to the next thing right now. So, everybody, we're going to introduce to you now. And, Martin, you got us on there?
Yeah, can you hear me? I can hear you.
I got you right there. So, for those that don't know, Martin was the operator of the train on the trestle. So, Martin, tell us a little bit about what you did during that shoot.
Well, first let me say that this is a steam locomotive, and there's two people that run the steam locomotive. There's the engineer that runs the throttle and the brakes, and there's the fireman that makes certain that their fire is producing enough steam and there's enough water in the boiler. On most of this stuff, I was the fireman. Malin Johnson was the engineer. So there was two of us, one on each side.
And what we'll do is I'm going to show you the video, and we're going to kind of play by play here of what was going on. We're going to start it off with this scene right here. Tell us a little bit about this scene that you're seeing right now.
I'm not seeing your scene, so I can see you.
You can't see me? Or you can't see the scene?
I can see you. I don't see the scene.
Hey.
Same property.
Let's see. I thought I shared that. Hang on here.
I don't see it on there.
All right, Mark, we actually had the scene where you were talking about they were on the trestle tracks with the train right behind you.
Right. Can you put that on so I can see it too?
Let me do this right here. All right. See if you got that. It's going to be little, but you can see it there.
It's very little. Extreme. You can't make it bigger?
Wait for it. Of course, this worked during the other times.
Right. Of course.
All right, I think that's about as big as I'm going to get it right there for you.
Okay, well, can everybody else see it a lot bigger than I am?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So, what you have to understand is it took an entire week to shoot this small, short scene. And this thing that I can barely see, it gives you many perspectives of what we were doing. First of all, the locomotive that I'm on that's coming down the track. We are actually going down grade. There you go. Now I can see it. Okay. We're actually going down grade towards the trestle. They wanted to do this because they thought the lighting was better for us going this direction than the opposite direction. So with my whole train coming behind me downgrade, it already was something we should be putting the brakes on rather than than turning on the throttle. But just leave it there, would you? Can you freeze it there?
Yep.
So this is one of the scenes that they actually had any of the actual actors on the bridge even remotely close to us. Otherwise, they were the, we used to call dwarf women, the stunt doubles, which were short, small women. What you can see here is one of the things that's been lost in a lot of the translation. If you look between the rails where the two boys are crouched, you don't see the rail ties, you actually see the plywood planks that Rob Reiner laid down so that the actors could pretend to be running on the ties, but actually still able to run on a normal surface. The problem was, because they were going back and forth between actors and stunt people and photographing it from the air, photographing it from boats, etc., they never nailed or screwed those plywood planks down. They just laid them on there so they could pick them up quickly, which meant that when the stunt doubles, the young women, were running, they were kicking up these plywood planks and they could have easily caught their toe on one of those edges as they jumped up and down because they weren't tied down. And so that was one of the things we saw. It was a huge danger in that when we had the stunt doubles in front of us, they were a lot closer than this train shows, they could have easily just tripped and there was not a thing we can do. We can't swerve and we can't stop. At this point in time, at the speed we were going, it was gonna take us a quarter mile to stop. And that was gonna be way too late for anybody that was in front of us. So what you have here is most of the scenes that you see in the movie never shot that we were on the bridge with the actual actors. This is one of the few ones, and they made us shut off immediately after this, and the actors, this is with a telephoto lens, they were in nowhere near. Otherwise, most of the scenes in the movie you're going to see are with the stunt doubles only.
Who he is, you may not never see him, and if you blink,
no,
pretty much,
you got about 5 times to blink.
Oh, 5 times. Yeah. I'll give you that. So,
I have about 5 clips of about 3 seconds each.
One of them he's in.
There.
He is right there. So tell us your name. Tell everybody who you are.
I'm Elvin Albertson, and I live in Halsey, which is 6 miles that way. And I don't remember just how I learned about that they wanted extras, whether it was in the Times or in the Register Guard. But I came over and I didn't have to have four or however many interviews. In fact, I don't think I was interviewed at all. They just took my picture and I filled out the paperwork. And then I knew the date that they were supposed to start filming. And so I called them the Friday before because they were filming the next Monday starting. And I told them who I was. And the lady said, are you available on Monday at 6 o'clock in the morning? You need to show up to the Brownsville Park. And I said, sure, I'll be there. Although 6 o'clock in the morning, no human should have to get up at that time. But anyway, so that's how I got into the film. And if I hadn't called, I probably wouldn't be in it. And since then, I've been milking it for all it's worth.
What is some of your most memorable moments of this particular scene?
They filmed this separately from the Barforama. They had two groups of about 15 or so people. And apparently we were more photogenic or whatever. And so we got, and the other crew got, or the other people got, they're on the cutting room floor, I guess. But we got into the movie. And so I was supposed to be one of the, what, elks or whatever they were.
Oh, yeah.
And I was in my mid-40s at the time. And so the first 3 days, I got paid $75 a day, which was pretty good money back in the 60s, I guess, for sitting around doing nothing, which is what we basically did. And then somebody in the chain of command decided that I didn't look old enough to be to wear antlers. And so I got bumped down to $35 a day for just a regular extra. And so for the, now we didn't have the, we didn't throw up in this part. That was in the Barforama, so when everybody was there. And they passed around little plastic baggies with cottage cheese and blueberries. And they didn't taste too bad. But, and they were going to do two takes of the Barforama. And so we had to put half of it in our mouth and hold it. And so they did the first take of it, and everybody barked and whatnot, the stuff on person ahead of us, I guess. And then they had to reset the cameras and whatnot. And so then they said, well, put the rest of that in your mouth and hold it until we tell you to action. About halfway through that part, I started to feel not too good. I was concerned I was going to throw up for real. And so,
see, that would have been a great take.
But they weren't coming yet. And so I thought, I better just swallow this and fake. So if they use that second cut, then I'm faking it. I didn't know they were going to shoot stuff over the top of us. Because if you watch the Barforama, you will see stuff flying up over us. Three or four, I think, places in the back where they were... Okay, it should be coming up fairly soon. Yeah, he's telling about it here now. It should come up.
Anybody want some castor oil?
Hopefully that was not castor oil. And I don't know if I tried to swallow a raw egg, I would have burnt also. Anyway. So they just shot this over us, and I don't think any of that ever hit me anyway. Also one thing you'll notice in the, okay, here it's coming up, when he throws up, look at the side of his face. Okay. He's getting ready. Ready, set. Terror and fear. See, it's below his mouth. They didn't have the tube properly set. And in the other ones that threw up, it was the same way. But,
that just looks wrong.
And also, we weren't in the shop that I was in. We were not, what's the term? A continuity, where you're supposed to match things. We were not sitting in exactly the same places that we were sitting when they did the Barbarama part. I told a fellow who was setting us up, well, we weren't sitting here when they did the other. And I guess they did the Barbarama before they filmed us. But anyway, he said, well, in this it doesn't matter because it goes by so fast and back and forth. And you mentioned the Man with No Name. I have something in common with Clint Eastwood. You might remember the movie he was in, The Man with No Name, I think it was in the old. It was the first one he did, the spaghetti western. And they never named, he didn't have a name. And so I'm not in the credits. And so I've been seen all over the world, but nobody knows my name. And
but they know now.
I've traveled in China and Japan. And hotels, I will mention that I was in the movie, and I had an 8x10 that I would show people. They could find it on the internet. And I don't know how they did it in China, because a lot of that stuff is blocked. But this one woman in the hotel found it, and I said, there I am. And so she was going to show it to her friends that she knew a movie star. With all my 15 seconds of fame.
Yeah, you're doing. Your family doesn't come visit you.
No, I know. Looks like he's got a little bit of
a
nothing
wants to pay,
Dad. Have you been to this every year?
No.
I've never been to this tour. Oh, really?
I mean, I've seen some of the spots
where
you
do
them, but I don't.
Caesar, you want to see? Hi. Aww. Okay. So you guys have...
So I ended up getting the book and a comb. All right, well, thanks for joining me for today's adventure. Had fun. If I had a rank or rate this year's to last year's, I did like last year's a little bit more. I believe they said that they were thinking about possibly doing two tours, a longer and a shorter one. They just didn't have, trying to pick up volunteers last minute. Although they did have more walking tour people this year than last year. I did notice they only had two last year, and this year I think they had like three. But yeah, overall, I definitely enjoyed it. Especially if you've never been, it is worth checking out. Yeah, I mean, two of the speakers were the same from last year. But then we had the fireman, I believe he was the fireman, on the train. He was there too. So yeah, definitely something to check out next year. They do it on the 23rd of July every year. Nope. Guess I need to flip the camera here. Alright, thanks for joining me on today's adventure. Let the bodies hit the floor. Let the bodies hit the floor. Let the bodies hit the floor.